So good morning and good evening to everybody who's listening from around the world. I'm Ilankurali Ilavarasan from India. I'm presenting my research on synthetic biology for gene editing on edible plants to thrive on Red Planet. And I'm particularly focusing on a specific plant on this study called as Moringa plant, that how it could survive on Mars. So without further ado, let's go into today's presentation. So my basic idea is that rather than taking plants that can only help us in surviving as a food source, it could also generate multi-purpose use. And selecting plants which can aid in a different varieties of uses, like being a benefit in psychological and physiological and also in nutritional benefit, can be an ideal candidate so that they can help us in many more different areas. So Moringa oleifera is one kind of plant which could help being a multi-purpose plant. So it's called as the drumstick tree in a colloquial language. And why I have chosen this specific plant is that it's antifungal, antiviral, antidepressant, and it also has anti-inflammatory properties, apart from being a very good source of food. And also, all the parts of the Moringa plant can be used in medicine making, and not just in medicine making, but also it could be used as food source. And here in the southern parts or the Asian parts, we use Moringa plant as a source of food even in a daily basis. And mostly, most parts of the Moringa plant could be used as a source of food. And that is a very less wastage. Plus, the Moringa plant releases lots of external parts, which could be used in preparation of other usage, like the gum which the tree releases can be used as a resin for 3D printing in space habitats, and also to build the layers of the habitats and maybe building of structural parts, etc., in the future. So this plant is adapted to the tropical regions of the Asia Pacific region. So there is a very different type of climatic this plant is accustomed to. So when we are taking this plant and using it to create the food sources or other sources on the red planet, that is Mars, there must be some kind of resistance the plant tree must have to radiation, to the extreme temperatures it might have there, or to resist any kind of external threats like pests or insects or anything of that kind of environmental stresses. So in order to do that, we can make use of the technique of gene editing. So this gene editing will prepare this plant to build its own protectants against abiotic stresses, against excessive amount of heat or salinity, or the excessive amount of ultraviolet radiation present on the red planet. And it will protect against the protein degradation that occurs under these kind of severe abiotic stresses. Maybe it could happen during the travel between the Earth to the red planet if we are taking young plants or even seeds. So how we do this is that by gene editing, and we can try to incorporate the sugar trehalose. So trehalose synthesizing gene, that is trehalose 6-phosphate phosphatase, that is OTSB, or the other gene OTSA, can be extracted using CRISPR technology and can be added to the Moringa seeds or the young plants. By this way, the gene-edited plants could be able to survive the extreme harsh conditions it may face on the Red Planet. And also, this can be tested during its stay on Earth by being sent to ISS or tested on the microgravity. And the grown plants can be tested before surviving on the Martian surface. So technically, we see Mars as a stepping stone for becoming an humans becoming an interplanetary species. And why is that? It is because considering the distance between Earth and Mars, and also the time period, that is the geochronology or the geological evolution of Earth and Mars, we say Earth, sorry, Mars has had a very similar kind of past when compared to Earth. But today, Mars is a very dry and barren planet, and it also raise a question that can life arise and outside our planet? So if any place in solar system nearby to Earth could have hosted life, or could have been hosting life right now, the first step taken towards it could be Mars. So that is why Mars has been always in pursuit for humans. Even since 1960, we have been sending lots of missions to Mars, and it is time for us to send manned missions to Mars, and I'm making Earth a better place even. But there are a few challenges in settling on Mars. Like when we are thinking about sending humans to another planet, there won't be stable supply of food, and preparing food or even taking food on a sufficient amount of scale would be impractical in terms of exchanging resources constantly from Mars and Earth, which will minimum take 7 months for transferring through space flight missions. And also, humans on Mars will need to move away from complete reliance on this kind of shipped goods, and they have to achieve a high level of self-sufficient and sustainable agriculture. In simple terms, meaning creating their or harvesting their own food. It's not much feasible because to send all the necessary resources to create food from scratch, like water or oxygen, is very improbable. And humans have to think of some way to produce all these things to on Mars. And it is not very easy because Mars itself is a very tough place with lots of differences between Earth and Mars, like high amounts of UV rays. And we know that the temperature is really, really low. That is, Mars is a very cold planet. And also, there is a 95% of carbon dioxide present over there. Plus, it doesn't have much of water, and any form of water present on Mars is in the form of ice, and the low atmospheric pressure and all the other phenomena which we see here makes it a pretty tough planet to start anything from scratch, and it doesn't form a very good ideal place for a plant growth as well. So that is why we have plant growth that challenges. Like the plants that are accustomed to Earth, they won't grow well on Mars because of the scarcity of water or the farming techniques. And also the growth medium, which we consider, if we consider Earth's soil, it is full of microbes and organic matter. But the Mars regolith is basically crushed rock, which has a very high pH of 9.5, 9.5. And also, that is a major challenge which we have to eradicate if we are thinking Mars regolith to be an ideal growth medium for Earth-accustomed plants. That is the presence of the toxic salt called calcium perchlorate, which is at least about 2% of the Martian surface. So, regarding all these growth challenges and the atmosphere of Mars, even we must have a criteria for selection of potential candidate crops, specially designed or specially selected to be grown in a Martian habitat. And the selection criteria is a very important factor, which will abide the adaptability of the plants, and it will also take into consideration the plant size, light requirements, the harvest index, also the nutritional value. Regarding all these adaptability, environmental constraints, the plant must also aid in lots of other constraints like health promotion, disease prevention, and psychological health. It simply means that a plant or plants which are selected as a food source or a main food source on another planet, it must be a multi-purpose plant. And that is where the idea about indigenous plants come into picture. So why indigenous plants is that they tend to be very nutritious. often they are more nutritious than the very popular kind of plants, which we, use in daily food here on Earth. And they are actually very well adapted to regions where they originate. And these regions are actually a very extreme kind of climatic or weather variations. They tend to grow in very acidic or alkaline soil, depending upon their area of growth. And also wherever they grow, they are kind of food crop that people on a mass rely off. So they come in a very wide range of variety and they survive really longer. They do have a natural kind of natural kind of mutant variation, so that they produce a very hardier and they become disease resistant to the area that they are acclimatized to. On addition to all these wonderful things indigenous plants offer, they do aid in medicinal purposes. So for centuries, indigenous people have been using these kind of plants for medicinal purposes, to make use of medicines from created from the plants, and they have even formed a system out of it. So there are lots of medicinal systems like Siddha and Ayurveda followed in cultures like Indian, where we use plants, that is indigenous plants, and produce medicines from them, and also infuse it with the daily food so that the food itself becomes medicine. So this is some kind of general idea where we can make use of these indigenous plants to not just form as food substance, but also it will be great to produce medicine and also aid in other issues like psychological and physiological issues. But these plants can't be taken directly towards the planet, and that is why we talk about gene editing in plants. So gene editing basically relies on DNA targeting, that is, they take up the entire plant and tend to use the molecular reagents to, in specific sites in complex genomes. So actually, gene editing it makes the plant to produce its own genetic variation. So sometimes, actually in plants, it occurs naturally, but genetic gene editing helps the genetic variation to surpass this natural production and to produce it by man-made. And it will introduce heritable mutations into plant genomes. So one of the most powerful gene editing technique is the CRISPR-Cas9, and it is a RNA directed DNA endonuclease adapted technique, and this could be a viable source where we can make use of the important the qualities to be there, to be present in a plant, and to avoid the qualities which we don't want in a plant before taking it to the red planet. So these are the three types of gene editing, basically like gene editing through a tissue culture where plants, they are a gene editor and it is grown from a tissue culture where the shoot develops first and after that the root is developed. So we can transport these tissues, tissue culture, like the cryogenic tissue, and they could be transported to the red planet in cryogenic modules, and the shoots can be grown there first, and after that the roots can be grown and they can be planted on the red planet for use, or gene editing through de novo meristem induction. So here actually the strain is developed into the strain, which it is introduced into the reagent, and then it is introduced into the plant, and the shoot actually develops like a structured form, and after that it is transferred into the soil, which grows into the next generation. And this is one another type of gene editing. So there is also the gene editing which is very famous with editing with RNA viruses. So a plant would be affected by the Cas9, the RNA from a planet expressing Cas9, which is a protein, and then the plants can be the plants which express this kind of RNA genes could be grown, and that is how they that is how they create their own progeny, and they mutate and form many plants. So these are different kind of gene editing techniques which could be used in these kind of plants. So this is the plant I am talking about, which is Moringa oleifera. We can see the different parts of the plant. So this is it's a flowering plant. The flower is also edible and used in lots of medicine making, food processes, and it also segregates oil, which is very good in making use of also in food. And the oil could also be, after research, it could also be used in many parts of a habitat. So this is the flower, and these are the leaf part, which is edible. So this leaf part does have lots of antioxidant, antidepressant properties, which could be aid in creation of medicine. And this is a staple food of the South Asia. So Moringa actually grows into a tree. So in order to suppress that genetic factor, we can gene edit the plants to just stay as plant, a younger plant up to a size, so that it doesn't overgrow in a habitat while we think on growing it on Mars. And this is the Moringa. It does grow into a vegetable. It's called as the drumstick in the colloquial language. It's actually a pod. So inside this pod, there is a seed, which is also edible. So it is actually steamed and cooked in various ways. This also helps in making fiber. So the pod does consist of an external shell, which can be woven into fibers. And also the bark and the stem, all of the parts of the Moringa oleifera tree we are talking about, is extremely helpful. And none of the parts goes into waste. So this is a wonderful tree. It's a wonder plant. And this could be a really revolutionary step in taking plants and gene editing them and thinking of them as a multi-purpose source while we are settling on the red planet, that is Mars. So thank you so much for listening to me. That is one of my idea. If you are interested in it, let's talk more about it and make it a success. This is Ilan Kurlilamasan signing off. So these are my contact details to contact me. Thank you so much for listening to me. Have a great day, everyone.